Pipebomb Radio.
What?
With your hosts, Felix Olmedo and Austin James.
This voice, this is power. In anybody else's hands, this is a microphone. In my hands, it's a pipe bomb. It's showtime! Woo!
Good evening. Welcome, welcome, welcome to this special edition of Wednesday night's Pipe Bomb Radio. We don't normally do them Wednesday nights, but you know, every now and then, we like to mix it up. And yeah, I think we're going to have some fun tonight. As you heard, as you followed, if you follow us on Facebook, I did mention this last night. There was a good, very good possibility that we may have had a special guest joining us tonight, and all things kind of fell together, and we did actually have him join us here. We will actually be calling him here in just a bit. Who am I talking about? Well, I'm talking about Oscar from Men on the Mission. Do you remember them? They were the rapping tag team. Mabel, Oscar, Mo, or Mo, Oscar, Oscar Mabel, however you want to say it. Playing was, it was M.O.M. from the new generation of WWF. Those of us who remember that era, grew up watching that era, I know I did, would watch this enormously popular tag team with the lead person who was their manager, Oscar, would come out and rap. You didn't see that during that time. At least I don't recall anybody really rapping in the ring.
You never really seen a person.
Nonetheless, I want to welcome everybody to the show. Of course, I'm your host, Felix, and Austin, I know you've been listening to me ramble here for a minute or two. How you doing tonight?
I'm not really doing that well.
I haven't been feeling well myself, personally, but other than that, you doing all right? I was actually, come to think of it, I'm not sure if you actually did or not. Did you actually catch the Monday night, the Raw flashback that was on the WWE Network tonight?
No, I did not. I wasn't seeing. I was actually watching some WCW matches on the Volume 2 set that I actually recently got. And I was like, hosting.
I think you took pictures of that too, didn't you?
Yeah, I took pictures of everything. You know, actually have these really good, really cool deals at Walmart now. Celebrating 30 years of WrestleMania at Walmart, where you go there and it's combination DVDs, three disc sets, and a T-shirt. An old WWE logo T-shirt they can get for $14 a piece, and it's different combinations. There's like, I think there's like 8 different combinations you can choose from.
Huh. Okay. I'll take a look myself because I was at Walmart the other day. But rather than kind of dilly-dally here too much longer, I'm going to go ahead and place a call over to Oscar, his name is Greg Girard.
And
he's actually awaiting our call.
One more thing. Oscar's actually one of the guys, one of the first people, like you were saying, to actually come out. I think he's maybe the first person ever to come out and be rapping, you know, from the ring, which eventually led on to people like, you know, R-Truth, Road Dogg, you know, different, you know, those guys. Yes, he kind of led the way, if you come to think of it, you know, for guys rapping when they walk to the ring.
Very true, very true. I mean, from that generation, you didn't see too much of that. And that's what I think I liked about it. I think that's what it really, you know, it got over so well during that time. But we'll talk about that with him right now. So let's just go ahead and give him a call here. All right. This is always a fun part for me because either I do it right or I don't. So here we go.
Hello,
sir. Thank you for joining us. This is Felix and, of course, my co-host, Austin. How you doing?
I'm all right, guys. How y'all doing?
Doing very well. Austin, you there?
Yes, I'm doing decent. You know, I'm under the weather tonight.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay.
We just wanted to thank you for taking time. I know you were a bit under the weather yourself. Would you prefer I call you Greg or Mr. Girard, or is it okay if I call you Oscar?
I don't want WWE to get mad at me now. Nah, you can call me Oscar.
All right. But, You know, growing up during that time, I would say a teenager during that time when you guys debuted in the WWF. Who came up with the idea of the Men on a Mission and you coming out and rapping to the ring?
Well, it all goes to the entire story of how Vince McMahon discovered me in Las Vegas, actually performing, and then I actually customized a rap on the spot for him, Macho Man Randy Savage, Jerry Lawler, Bruce Pritchard. They was all in. Vince was kind of impressed, so he told me to call him at the WWF headquarters the following Monday. I did. We had a long conversation. 2 months after that, he flew me out to Connecticut, where I met Mo and Mabel, and it was in the boardroom that he came up with the names Mabel, Mo, Oscar, M-O-M, Men on a Mission.
You know, we were just talking about this before I called you. Seeing you do what you did, you know, it was something that hadn't been done at least up to that point. I mean, you paved the. We'd like to think, or at least I would like to think for sure that you got it started for guys like R-Truth, who would rap to the ring. Of course, you know, Road Dogg, Jesse James. He would, you know, do his little spiel to the ring as well. I mean, you kind of got it started when nobody was really doing it, at least in my opinion. Just to my recollection, I mean, I don't recall anybody else doing what you guys did back then.
Nah, well, I mean, out of humility and with a bag of boastfulness, always say that I am kind of like the godfather of hip-hop and wrestling. I mean, you have, you know, John Cena came out, you know, rapping and to rap music, and just, you know, recently it all ties in with, you know, they had Eminem doing the theme song for Bray Wyatt. So I mean, everything goes back to a pioneer or pioneers, which Men on a Mission as a collective is. It all goes to pioneer of a movement, and the movement goes, and as hip hop grows, the movement stays within the collective of the WWE, and now they use it. And the fact that I was one of the people that did it early on, I mean, that's something that I have pride about.
Absolutely.
Now, were you getting into WWE, were you a fan of wrestling, or were you just getting into it because they noticed you?
Oh, no. I mean, I knew who everybody was when I saw them. See, when I was about 10 years old, my father called me and my brother in to watch WWOR TV and Channel 9 in New York. And that's when I first saw Bruno Sammartino and Dusty Rhodes and, you know, a whole bunch of the other ones. And, you know, Andre the Giant. And I was a gigantic fan, you know, ever since that happened. So, you know, and going to Madison Square, took us to Madison Square Garden, where I first saw Bruno and Hulk Hogan and Dusty Rhodes and Ivan Putski and, you know, all them. I mean, I go back that far seeing it live, which ties into a 1 minute story. It was thinking about being at Madison Square Garden with my father, and the first time I went to Madison Square Garden to actually participate with Mo and Mabel in a match coming out, I could actually look at those nosebleed seats and almost see myself, and it was so prolific. I mean, you know, but to answer your question, yeah, my fandom, my Marxism goes way back to my childhood.
And getting the chance to work with somebody else who I kind of grew up idolizing myself was the Macho Man Randy Savage. Now, you were in there, as you know, in the last few years he was a part of the WWF. What was it like interacting with him, working with him? I believe you guys even did a rap video with him, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, I have a lot to thank the Macho Man for, because it was him in tandem with Vince that thought that I would make a good manager in the WWF when I first did the rap for that, because he was the one I personalized the rap for first, and he was a real mentor to me, along with some others I give credit, like Bob Backlund, Bret Hart, you know, I mean, the list goes on, but he kind of mentored me, and yeah, doing that rap with Randy Savage, and you can catch that rap on YouTube, the Lex Express rap, Macho Man Raps with Men on a Mission. Yeah, that was a song that we both wrote, that we both put together. You know, I kind of helped him out, smoothed out, you know, his parts of the rap and everything like that, and we had a real good time with it. And when I see that video, I'm proud to have worked with that man.
Yeah, that'd be just an awesome experience in itself, and, you know, I can't even imagine how much fun it was to work back then with so many great guys, as you mentioned, like Brett and Randy and Bob and so many others. You guys actually had a really good run and even went as far, I'm not sure if you recall this, but you probably do, I'm sure you get asked this quite a bit, was the Survivor Series when the Men on a Mission, well, Mo and Mabel, they teamed with the Bushwhackers and put the Doink clown, the Doink the Clown mask, makeup and wig on and had some fun.
That had to be, that happened in the Boston Garden, and that was Survivor Series 94. That has to be, excuse me, I'm sorry.
No problem.
That has to count among one of the top 10 biggest, brightest moments that I had, you know, during my tenure there. It was fun being a doink, fun being a clown. That was a fun match. Matter of fact, I think that goes down in history as one of the top weirdest matches in WWF history, if I'm not mistaken. But it was a blast to do that.
Now, you're talking about, you know, being actually in WWF at the time. How was it backstage? Was it like a fun environment, or was it kind of like, you know, walking an eggshell?
Not at first. The first, I would say, almost year was far from fun because I got hazed a lot. I mean, I got a rims pulled on me like nobody's business. The Steiner brothers were brutal when it came down to, you know, ribbing me and all of the kind of stuff like that. And, you know, you might think on the outside it was funny, but it really wasn't. I went through a lot of hell because, I mean, in all honesty, you know, there's a flip side to everything. I don't just paint, a rosy picture. There was a lot of things where I was tested by some individuals. Because, I mean, there was a lot of individuals, and like anything else, they didn't want you there. So they were going to do everything they could to try to break you and run you out. But, you know, I withstood the test of time. And, you know, I mean, it went on until they were like, well, we done did everything we can do to this guy. He ain't going nowhere. They ain't going nowhere. So, I've been through it. But once it evened out, and once it was pretty much, over that hump, then everything went smooth sailing, and everything else went great.
All right. And I was going to ask you now, it came to a point after a few years of a good run that they wanted to turn the guy's heel and have them turn on you.
Yeah.
Everything okay?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, it's okay. I was just going to ask about the heel turn when they had the guys had to. They ended up losing you as a manager. How did you, after that day, did you actually part from WWE? Did you stick around for a little bit longer? And after that, what happened to you? I mean, were you a part of the wrestling team?
No. Yeah, no, that day, which happened in North Charleston, South Carolina, no, that was the day that I said goodbye to wrestling, and I said goodbye to it for many years. Right after that, I went straight into other entertainment ventures out in Los Angeles. Then I migrated to Chicago, where I did radio for a number of years, you know, before I even, you know, it was just recently over the last couple of years that I, you know, started reappearing at conventions on radio shows such as this. Thanks for having me, by the way, and on an independent circuit.
And I wanted to ask you, you mentioned you were talking about pranks. Did you actually ever get a prank by the one and only Owen Hart?
Owen Hart, yeah, I was asleep, and this was in, this was overseas somewhere in Europe. I was asleep, dead sleep. I woke up and I was drenched in shaving cream from head to toe, and come to find out later on it wasn't nobody buttholing.
Oh no! So you did get, you were definitely a victim of one of Owen's infamous attacks or ribs in this case.
No, Owen was notorious for doing it. God bless his heart. But another story with Owen. Owen was one of my mentors. Owen would actually help me work out and actually help me lift weights. And one of the biggest memories that I had with Owen was Owen and I, when we were in Rome, we went to the Colosseum and we toured it together. You didn't look at it. And we were playing Bruce Lee and Chuck Norris on one of those columns up there. So I got a picture of me and him in there somewhere that I cherish. And that's one big memory that I have with Owen Hart.
And looking back on your stint with WWE, I'm not sure if you've been asked this, you might have. Do you look back with any regrets at all? Maybe something you could have done, something you should have done. Maybe you could have jumped ship to WCW like most were doing towards the latter part of the 1990s?
You know what? That's a fair question. And the answer is, I don't have no regrets. I don't have none at all. I think that me being there and the Lord putting me in that position, you know, helped me build a legacy with two amazing gentlemen that will stand forever. And I am so, so proud of the both of them, Bobby Horn and Nelson Frazier. God bless his soul, recently passed away, as most people know. And it was a thing that I said at his services. I would never regret it, because at a time when I needed a brother in my life, God put two brothers in my life. And for that, I'm more grateful about that aspect of it than all the fame of it, the money that came with it, or anything else. So just to spend my life, you know, with those two amazing young men, that's something that I could never regret, not an aspect of it. I'm proud of it. I love them both. You know, again, God bless Nelson's soul. He's with me forever. And I've no regrets at all.
That's a really great explanation and great point to hit on, because some people go in for the money, some people go in for the experience, some people go in and they do both, and some people actually go in and actually not only do they leave their mark, they make good money, but they leave with some great friends and extra people in their family, so to speak. They come, you know, with great relationships, great friendships that get built, and you definitely build some with Nelson and Bobby. And you said you were going to be attending some more Legend conventions. Did the interest getting reacquainted with your fans, did that start to spark in you again? Did you said you might be attending a Legends convention here soon? I know it gets really fun around WrestleMania with every, you know, when they're in New Orleans, they have a lot, the WrestleCon and everybody else coming out, you know, doing their thing for meet and greets and wrestling shows around the area. Will you be in New Orleans as well, or will you be in the other part of the area meeting with the fans?
Well, first off, before I answer that, I'm gonna answer that. I want to take this time to tie in the answer to that to thank everybody for all their well wishes and prayers for Nelson, Cassandra Frazier's wife, and his family, and for us since his passing. The support that everybody is giving Mo, he has his own health issues with his kidneys, and as we speak right now, I'm in a hospital bed right now doing this interview. I had a kind of like a stroke episode a couple of days ago, but I'm fine. They ruled out a major stroke. I didn't have one. I'm in a hospital undergoing tests, and yeah, God willing, I get discharged tomorrow. And I'm going to be in Fort Wayne, Indiana, at the Heroes and Legends Fan Fest convention that's going to be this Saturday in Fort Wayne at the Clarion Fun Dome. As far as New Orleans, I have no plans to go there, because that same weekend we're having the official tribute to Nelson, maybe Big Daddy, via Ripley, Tennessee, and that's more than likely where I'm going to find myself. So, I mean, yeah, big celebration, WrestleMania weekend. I'm just going to be celebrating in other parts of the country.
Now, for the actual Nelson official tribute show, what do you have planned?
It's going to be a night of wrestling, a night of remembering, a night of everybody that knew him and loved him getting together in Ripley, Tennessee. We're just going to have, you know, we're not going to have we had the memorial service already, so now it's time for a celebration, to celebrate an incredible life with all the wrestlers in Tennessee he worked with, you know, with all of his fans in that area, and we just gonna set it off and just, you know, remember him in a positive way.
You know, go ahead, Austin.
I was gonna say, do you have any like special rap planned that you're gonna do at the show? Because I mean, we haven't heard, you know, you rap in quite some time.
Well, I'm gonna be rapping this Saturday in Fort Wayne, and me and Mo are gonna for the first time in almost 20 years, we've done fan fests and conventions together, but for the first time in almost 20 years, he's actually participating in a match, and I'm going to be rapping him out. And that's the first time I've done that in 20 years. I'll also be rapping him out in Tennessee, and I'll also be rapping him out in Providence, Rhode Island, which is going to be in June. Providence at the Crown Plaza at the New England Fan Fest a situation that's going to be in June in Providence. So I will be rhyming at all three of those. And for the record, it's all for a good cause and all for the reunion, because I really don't rap, perform no more like I used to, but I'm going to make an exception in 2014.
It's all about having fun. I mean, I know with Nelson's passing, it was definitely felt throughout the wrestling industry. A lot of his, like you mentioned, a lot of his former coworkers, I know for a while, I know that Chris Masters actually, you know, wouldn't quite mention how much he, you know, he enjoyed working with them. He even put his profile picture as, you know, as Nelson. And a lot of people would talk about how many great memories they shared with truly one of the nicest and most respectful big men in the business, because he definitely didn't move like a big man. He moved like somebody who could really fly in the ring. I mean,
you know, when you mention that, I have got to tell you that it was the very first time that I saw, because I didn't know Nelson and Bobby before before the Men on the Mission thing. They flew me to Connecticut, and when I got there, going up to the big meeting, they drove up in a car. Now, a couple of stories with that. When Nelson got out the car, I could not believe the size of this guy. I mean, I'm saying hi to him, and I'm looking at where his navel is on his stomach. I needed a stepladder to, you know, to meet him eye to eye to speak to him. But the first time I saw them work in the ring, I could not believe my eyes. I could not believe the double moves they did, being the size of both of them. Both of them doing drop kicks, and Nelson doing his Japanese spin kick. It blew my mind. The first match we had was, I said, I got something special right here. I got some bad boys right here, and we are going to tear up the wrestling industry. We're going to take it by storm. I was so shocked, but I was so proud.
Yes, definitely. I mean, now, I wanted to ask you, with everything that's been going on, do you actually still, you know, do you keep up with what's going on in the wrestling world? I mean, obviously the WWE owns pretty much everything now. I mean, do you watch that? Do you watch maybe TNA or maybe Ring of Honor or any other wrestling company, be it through TV or internet?
Oh, I watch WWE every week. I keep up with the programs. I mean, as a matter of fact, my wife Tamara, I got her into it. She's like the biggest wrestler to say. She's a bigger fan than I am. You know, I watch it. I keep up. I mean, I think that the luster that it's kind of lost, the luster that it's had, you know, back like during the Attitude Era and all that, you know, the mystique of, you know, another, what I'm trying to say is, you know, people appreciated wrestling as a whole more when there was mystery behind it, when people questioned whether it was real or not. That's what gave wrestling its edge. And then today, and I've said this before, and I stand by what I'm saying, today, even though the stars are entertaining and they're good looking and they're everything like that, it's not the same thing. It's not like, I don't see where, you know, besides a handful, your John Cena's, your Randy Orton's, you know, your, you know, a lot of it, they don't build stars for longevity. They don't build Hulk Hogan's anymore. They don't build Dusty Rhodes anymore. It's like, you know, they don't build Undertaker's anymore. It's like, okay, if Daniel Bryan don't show up, people will care. If John Cena don't show up, people will care. They might go get their money back because they want to see John. They paid to see John Cena. But if Fandango don't come, nobody's gonna go get a refund. If Kofi Kingston didn't make it, nobody's gonna go get a refund. I'm sorry to say, if Dolph Ziggler don't show up, nobody's gonna go get a refund. So it's not like it was back then when you built legends, and that's what the WWE needs to get back to. They need to mold more characters that they found legendary. Instead of having people just come on the scene, beat everybody up, get the title, and they have nowhere to go, you know, they don't win up in 10 minutes, and they have nowhere to go but down, you know, develop characters like they used to. Let them climb up the ladder inch by inch, and that way you'll have characters for longevity more. But that's just my opinion.
You can look at guys like
really great
like
point.
Stone Cold,
go ahead, Austin.
Like Stone Cold Steve Austin, who started as you know, Stunning Steve Austin, and he eventually worked his way up to becoming, you know, Stone Cold Steve Austin, that icon that people know him as, and then that's a star that people. I mean, he connected with everybody because people would connect with him really easily. I mean, just like you connected with the fans when you walked out, you know, doing your rap, you really had them, you know, you really hooked them in.
No, right. I mean, yeah, no, you make a good point. You know, like, take The Rock. The Rock didn't start on the scene as a big star. He started off as Rocky Maivia. He built his way up, and now The Rock is one of the biggest stars on the planet. And I echo what you just said. You know, Stone Cold, he didn't start off as Stone Cold. He was Stunner Steve Austin. He built a career. You know, he was the Shockmaster. And then, you know, then years later, he was the biggest thing in wrestling. Now he's going to go down in history as one of the greatest of all time. This is what wrestling needs to get back to. This is what they need to do for more, you know, for more stars of the game.
You know, I've got a question. Two questions, actually. Number one, let's just say a year goes by, and you just put a scenario to you. They want to go ahead and put Nelson in the WWE Hall of Fame. Would you be there?
If I'm invited, definitely. I would be hurt beyond belief if I was not called to induct him. And you can say that. Your wrestling magazines can print it, because Bobby and I would make, you know, we are the only two people that I can think of, God willing and let us live to see that day. We're the only two people that I could see that would be right to induct him into the Hall of Fame.
That's a great point. Have you and Bobby ever really thought to, I mean, because nowadays it just seems that everybody's doing this, but have you guys ever thought about maybe creating your own podcast and just having some fun with it and talking about back in the day, talking about when you guys were, you know, growing up as wrestling fans and just kind of interacting with the fans through the podcast? Is that something that would ever intrigue you and Bobby to do together, a little project together?
You know, we're actually swimming our way through quite a few, batting around of quite a few ideas now. I mean, we were talking the other day about meeting with some producers about possibly doing a reality show, about possibly opening up a Southern promotion together. But, yeah, a radio show with him and I think it would be successful. So you make a good point. And I'm going to tell you what, Felix, I'm going to off air, you know, I'm going to talk to you more about how to do that, and we'll get on a conference call, and maybe we will work together and get something like that happening.
I'd be more than happy to help you with that. But, you know, now in the day of in the era of the social media, where everything is done, you know, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Pinterest, as Austin likes to point out to everybody who listens in about my Pinterest.
Oh, yeah. He has a really nice vegetable garden that he promotes on Pinterest. You should check it out.
I don't know about that.
There's a really nice flower and vegetable garden they put some Pinterest to me, and it's really impressive.
All right, that'll be enough, Austin. Hush up now. But I wanted to ask, Oscar, do you take part in a lot of that social media? I know you have a Facebook. Do you do any other interactions in social media?
No, I mean, I'm not a social. I need to get more into it, being a quarter of a way public figure, but not really. I mean, I read by the Facebook news to see what people are doing, catch up and see what's going on, but I don't post every day and post every week and take snapshots of what I had for dinner. And, you know, I'm at the store now. I'm at Walmart. These shoes are too tight. You know, I haven't gotten into it like that, but I think I'll probably will get more into it, you know, as time goes on.
All right.
I promise.
You
know,
go ahead, Austin.
People still want to connect with you because I think Felix seen this a couple of weeks ago. It was actually on the first day of the WWE Network, the opening of WWE Network. They played the Men on a Mission, like that music video you guys did. You know, we're on a mission. Well, they played that actual music video the first day the WWE Network opened.
Oh, really? Oh man, I'm honored. WWE Network, wow. Yeah, I mean, it's a thing to where I'm proud of that because a lot of wrestling fans that may not know about Men on a Mission, you know, I'm glad that the WWE is keeping it alive, and, you know, it gives you a whole, you know, you guys just answered a question for me. I wasn't asked to do too many things over the years. A lot of times people said they couldn't find me, and I guess they got tired of looking. But more and more, you know, Bobby Horn, he keeps his hand on the pulse of the independent wrestling community and wrestling circuit. He's getting all these calls for him and I to go here, there, and everywhere. So I'm guessing that's got a lot to do with it. So, you know, thanks to Triple H, Vince, Stephanie, and everybody at WWE and Creative for keeping Men on the Mission alive. I really appreciate it, and I appreciate the fans that stick by us, and I appreciate the new fans that are coming in that are getting to know us. You know why there's a John Cena come out the rap. Know why R-Truth is rapping. Know why this, that, the other one. And, you know, I mean, yeah, I'm just humble right now. Thank you for letting me know.
Yes, that was something he definitely pointed out to me when we were still working out, you know, a good time to bring you on. It definitely gives an opportunity, as you were saying, for older fans to look back and remember with fondness about the great, you know, some great times in the wrestling business as a fan. And, of course, new generations get reintroduced to who Men on a Mission were, what they did, how much fun they had. And, I mean, they had the interaction with the fans. The fans were eating that up. They were loving you guys. You know, it was something that was so not done. It wasn't done before. I mean, it wasn't something that you'd see on a weekly basis on WCW or on ECW or even WWF. It was new. It was fresh. It was fun. And now with the WWE Network, they can get reintroduced year after year after year. New fans get reintroduced to who Men on a Mission were. And I really think that with that, I mean, obviously you do have a Facebook. I think more fans will want to reconnect and find out how you and Bobby are doing, or if you guys will ever really, you know, be at conventions, where you're going to be and so forth. I think it's a great thing in this case with you know, everything that's being done now to look back and remember with fondness.
Yeah, I mean, it's a thing to where, I mean, you know, things in life come full circle. I mean, you know, you do something, and it's just a shock to me and an honor that 20 years later, you know, you still have a relevance to some people. I mean, there are no words to describe, you know, how I feel if one person can remember anything that I did or I had an impact on one person as a fan out there. You know, that's something I'm humbled. I appreciate it, and anything I'm able to do more from here forward, I'm more than happy to. So I'm here to say on the radio or public, you know, thank you guys from the bottom of my heart. And that comes from me, Mo, and it comes from Nelson up there in heaven. Thank you guys. Thank you guys. Thank you.
You know, I wanted to mention one last thing here. I know Bobby has been promoting it, but I wanted to throw it in there so that way you can talk about it a little bit as well. I know Mrs. Frazier has done a DVD where she kind of talks about some things that went on in WWE or tell some stories about Nelson and your guys' run or even maybe memories that she has. Do you know anything about that?
I heard it was being done, but at this particular minute, I don't know the content of it. I haven't seen it. I know that they were doing it. You told me about it, but I got to honestly say it isn't a shoot. I don't know anything about it. I'm waiting to see it myself, so I really don't have a comment on it because I haven't seen it. I mean, I know they were doing it, and I'm anxious to see what it is and what the reaction is going to be behind it. So, you know, I guess I'll comment on it later on when it comes up.
Now, if, say, a young up-and-comer reached out to you and, you know, did research on what you did, you know, what you had done in the WWE and wanted to model maybe his career to be a very, you know, a similar type manager that you were, be somewhat like you and like maybe wrap his team to the ring, what advice would you offer that person?
The same thing Russell Crowe said in Gladiator, win the crowd, you'll win your freedom. In other words, win the crowd, and success is your oyster. That's my advice.
Great advice. Now, Austin, did you have any final words for Oscar?
Definitely. I was going to say, I mean, not many people at all actually go out and, you know, accomplish what they want to do in life, and you actually, you know, went out and really did something remarkable that people will remember you forever. Like I was saying, like 5 minutes ago, that I mean, the first opening day of the WWE Network where basically wrestling changed, I think, you know, forever, because this is a really big time for wrestling. They played the Men on a Mission, you know, music video, and I was so excited to see that when it actually happened because they, I mean, it was the first day. And just to show how much respect they have for you guys, for you, then they played it just, you know, for the first programming on the WWE Network, which was really cool to see. But, you know, really, you know, I want to really congratulate you for all your success that you've actually had.
Well, thank you, and I appreciate that. Again, I'm humbled by it. I'm thanking the WWE right now for doing that. And, you know, just the fact that I could have done something to contribute to something so monumental, you know, makes me proud. I'm sure it makes my wife proud, my kids proud, everybody that know me, all my family, friends, and fans out there. I just appreciate everything. You know, if there's anything I can do further to enhance the business in a positive way, I'm going to do that. And like I said, I didn't even know about that until you guys told me. So I'm, like, really almost teary-eyed right now. WWE, Triple H, and everybody down there, thank you. Thank you, thank you.
And my last question, I know I said that already, but I had to mention it because I talked about one of my other childhood idols. I had to mention, what was it like working... I'm not sure if you guys got to, if they did as a tag team or not, but did you ever get the opportunity, and if so, what was it like interacting and working with The Undertaker?
Oh, yeah. I mean, The Undertaker was on the roster when I was there, so I got to see him almost every day. Mabel and him had some awesome matches, you know, against each other. You know, I got to talk to him, learn from him, play cards with him. I mean, you know, everything. So just to be around during the Undertaker era, as I call it, because he was one of the biggest stars on the roster at the time. So, yeah, him and the late, great Paul Bearer. I mean, you know, I learned. See, it was a thing to where, you know, I had the skill of rapping that God gave me. You know, I knew how to move the crowd, but it was people like Paul Bearer, and Jim Cornette and people like that, and of Alpha and Mr. Fuji, that actually taught me how to be a ringside manager, because those skills I was lacking. So I learned from watching them how they got the crowd going during the matches, how they coached, you know, their boys in the ring and all of the kind of stuff like that. Those were skills that I did not know, and the tools that I didn't have. So, you know, those are the people that taught me, so that, you know, made me a better manager in wrestling.
That's awesome. Well, you know, on behalf of Austin and myself, Oscar, we want to thank you so much. Really do. I mean, you're a trooper. I mean, you said it yourself. You're sitting in a hospital bed right now talking with us. We're very happy and glad that all is well, and there's nothing wrong, you know, physically, or you won't have to be there much longer. And God is watching over you, and of course, you also, you and Bobby and Mrs. Frazier have a guardian angel watching over you guys now.
Guys, I really appreciate this interview. And Felix, we're going to talk soon, and I hope
sure.
to get up with you guys at an event. Love to meet you.
Absolutely, absolutely. Sir, you have yourself a great night. Get some rest. And from both of us,
okay.
we wish you the best, and God bless.
Again, thanks for having me.
All right. Good night, sir. You know, I really enjoyed that interview. I mean, going back and remembering their debut, and you know, that was a great touch to add there. That really, I have a feeling that really made his night.
I know. I mean, just saying that after, I mean, WWE Network actually played his, the one that he sung the music video for Men on a Mission, that's really honorable because that was the first opening day, and I don't know if you're watching, you actually seen that, but I mean, I think I might have sent it to you. When I actually seen it on TV, but it was so cool just to see it happen, you know, right there on the first opening day of the network.
Absolutely, I mean, Nick, you know, we were talking about it for quite a few minutes there, and just how the idea of this is to definitely keep, you know, bring back some of the older fans so they can look back and like I was talking about earlier about the Raw from 1999 when Triple H crashed Stephanie's wedding to test. I was watching that earlier before we did the show tonight, and the crowd was so, so, so different back then than it is now. I miss those days. I miss the crowd reactions. You get those very rare times when the crowd is so hyped and just ready and into the matches or into the superstars as passionately as they were back then. And, you know, Oscar definitely hit the nail on the head with the idea, you know, the idea that it's a surprise. Nothing is a surprise anymore. Everybody knows everything, when it's going to happen, who it's going to happen to, who's doing it, who's coming back. There's no element of surprise anymore, and that's I feel that's hugely lacking.
That's what I was going to say. I mean, people always talk about the Attitude Era and how great it was, but it truly was great, and it's not. And I think people are actually starting to, I mean, everybody wants it back, but you know, there's never going to be another time like that was. The fans are different, and there's, I mean, the fans that were in the 90s, you know, have grown up and they have children, you know, I would imagine right now, and the ones that are watching. I mean, the Attitude Era, how it was so unique because the fans, like you were saying, were really into it. Like, I'm not, it's kind of a different, I don't know, like, the way the fans were into it is different from how it is now, because the WWE pushed the envelope a lot, which made the fans kind of go over with them.
Absolutely. You know, and we really do hope you guys enjoyed this little special, you know, night that we did tonight for you guys. You know, personally for me, I think it went really, really well. And, as they were saying, you know, I was talking about this for a second, just to go back and talk about how it came to be that Men on a Mission was created, seeing, you know, his reaction to working with Mabel and how big he was, and what they're going to be doing and so forth. I think it was just, I really enjoyed this. I really did.
Same here. And people that actually want to check out the tribute show they're actually be doing for Nelson, it's going to be on April 5th, and I can't, it's a, there's a poster up on I think it was on Bobby's Facebook page right now.
I believe it is, yeah.
And if you haven't seen it, we're going to post it up on Pipebomb later tonight so people can, you know, check it out.
Absolutely, absolutely. Now, before we close, we're going to just do a quick reminder again, of course, of this weekend's shows. We got Saturday Night Slam, the Last Ride Tour, continuing on, and Episode 2 of Pro Wrestling Historical Society with your hosts, Greg Skelly and Jimmy Wheeler. Well, I tried my luck at being a ring announcer. I guess that didn't really work. It was horrible. And, you know, Austin, I didn't realize it just by your voice. You're not your usual uppity, perky, obnoxious self. You really are not feeling all that well, and you're a trooper for hanging in there with me tonight. Like I told
just
you didn't have to.
Just wait
you
a
know.
Week, and I'm going to be back in action, you know, more than
well,
ever before.
Like I told
I might
like
not
I told
have
Oscar,
my...
I definitely want you to get some rest too, young man.
I might not have my voice technically being right now is 110%, but I promise you by Saturday, hopefully I can dish out some you know, Austin James action. One person needs it most because, I mean, there needs to be a set, you know, the line set before the last two shows on, you know, to show everybody where I stand, and that's not where, I mean, I'm actually really glad that the show is actually ending. Saturday Night Slam, I mean, Jesus Christ, that is the most, I never had the most boring time of my entire life every single week. He's talking, you know, I'm not even going into it. That was
well,
terrible.
You know, just the people we had to talk to, I mean, we had
it was mainly
Dylan,
you.
We had Porsche Zach, and then, of course, we had our special guest, Julia Hart, join us one night.
The only person
I love her,
that
by the way. She's
Julie.
Always going to be a very dear friend of mine, and I'm very proud of that.
That was probably
just for the opportunities itself, Austin, I know you can attest to this as well. The adventures that we've had over the last year and a half, making connections with people who grew up idolizing and respecting, even before our time, you know, it establishes a relationship, a friendship that I could tell you now, had I been a young man doing this, say, back when I was a younger man, like maybe Austin's age, and doing something like this, I would never expect it to be able to speak to these many great men and women that we've had. And the adventure continues, let me tell you, because like mm-hmm. I mentioned, we have wrestling manager extraordinaire, Sonny Ono, joining us on Tuesday, along with Austin's good pal and buddy, the bearded man himself, Jack Jameson, coming back and telling us some Lance Storm stories.
Amen. Lance Storm Wrestling Academy, all the way in Canada. Alberta, you know, Calgary Alberta Academy. He's actually trained there. He's actually tag team champions with Paul London, who's actually been on the show before. And if anybody hasn't actually seen that show, then you're missing out because it was pretty crazy. I mean, he was doing it inside of a grocery store while we were talking to him. And that was one of
Well, you know, stranger things have happened on the show, man. I mean, we had a grocery store interview. Tonight we had a hospital bed interview.
Oh,
you know,
that's
where are we going to be doing interviews next? Somebody might.
Probably,
I think we even did one when somebody was driving home.
I think,
yeah,
Darius Thomas, I think, was he was actually driving home. So, you know, we should do an interview at WrestleMania. Then we might not even hear anything on the line.
Well, if we can get somebody to come join us that weekend, I wouldn't mind it. I'm being serious.
Saying,
I wouldn't mind doing a show that weekend. And even though you may not be available, you might be able to call from wherever you're at and be like, ha-ha, Felix, you wish you were here, and I'm here, and you're not. Ha-ha.
That's what I'm saying. I can be like, we can have the show during WrestleMania, so nobody's gonna hear a thing. During WrestleMania, I'm talking about.
Oh no,
show,
I don't mean by WrestleMania.
Nobody's
gonna
hear one thing. They might hear yes. They might hear yes and no, depending on how the main event goes out. But that's probably the only thing they're gonna hear over the line.
That reminds me. I wanted to ask you about this. I forgot to ask you last night. I was not real thrilled. But I think they did this for a reason by pushing a little bit more emphasis on the possibility of it being a triple threat. When Triple H decided to insert himself and say either it's going to be him or Daniel that are going to be in the main event, I wasn't thrilled. Let's just say I was kind of not happy about it because, for one thing, he's supposed to be the boss. And what's he going to do, put himself as champion? And then what? It just goes to prove the point that many people believe that although he's running NXT, he's going to keep them under his thumb, and nobody's going to be a bigger star than he was.
Hey, I'm not saying that. I mean, I'm a fan of Triple H. You just have to know that being the person that he is, he's going to insert himself either way. I mean, he's done it at SummerSlam. He's done it at multiple events.
Yeah.
Because he's Triple H. I have no problem with him. I actually really enjoy his time. He's one of my. He's. I think he's going to go down as one of the best because he really was. And he still has that in. He has that shape. He's still really in, really good in shape. As you've seen this past Monday night on Raw, where he destroyed. And I felt. I don't know if you felt the same. And really bad for Daniel Bryan. He got beat. I mean, real bad.
Well, I think
bad
they did that to prove a point. They still want to make him look like the underdog. That's what I said. I get the point behind what they're doing with this. They want to make sure to put a little more emphasis on the possibility that there will be a triple threat. But who is it going to be? Will Daniel Bryan be able to make it to WrestleMania after the horrendous beatdown that he got from Triple H and Stephanie? Well, Triple H. And then the slapping contest that he got into. Well, Stephanie, I've heard she slaps hard, too. But,
definitely,
you know,
like
what's going to happen? Obviously, there's going to build up to the big. And you know what? I will let you come on here that Tuesday. after WrestleMania and be like, I told you Danny was going to get put in the main event and going to win the title.
Yeah, I've been saying that for the past 9 months.
What if he doesn't actually come out there with the championship, and how many thousands of people are going to be booing at the New Orleans Superdome?
Okay, let me ask you this question. What if Brock Lesnar, the beast incarnate, my personal advocate, defeats The Undertaker at WrestleMania for the streak? Will you be mad? It actually might actually happen. This year, you never know. You might be wrong this time. What would it be the first time?
Well, here's the thing. If
remember,
it was Brock,
I'm always right.
If it was anybody else, if it was Brock or anybody else, there's just no chance. Here's the reason I think that the only way that I would see Undertaker ever allowing the streak to end is if there was somebody credible enough, good enough, to take it.
Who is? Name one guy.
Shawn Michaels did not need it. Triple H did not need it. CM Punk did not need it.
Okay,
Brock Lesnar doesn't need it.
Then who is?
Well, there are obviously going to be more speculation as time goes on about reality actually happening and us and Undertaker getting to get in the ring one last time. Well, according to this person anyway, it would against Sting. Sting wants to have his final match against The Undertaker. And I would love to see them build this over a year's time like they tried to do with The Rock and Cena. True, Undertaker only appears very few and very often, but they don't have to have any kind of physicality between them. Both can cut good promos. Sting can pop in and be around a little bit more, but he doesn't have to wrestle. You know, but to build it over a year's time, after the, you know, either at WrestleMania or the night after, and build it up to WrestleMania 31 in Northern California.
Woohoo! And you, it's kind of like a. I'm not comparing Cena, I mean, not Cena, I'm not comparing Taker versus Sting with Cena versus Rock, but what they did for 28, I mean, really built it up. That was a lot of promotion for that one match. And if they did that,
you're right, there was.
Yeah, if they did that with Sting and Undertaker, I think it'd be something really special. Maybe one of the greatest matches you'll see, because at their age, they're one of the only few legends left that can actually put on a great match and still, I mean, look good.
Yeah,
while they're doing it.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if. Not only does Sting retire, but The Undertaker retires next year. I don't like it. I'm sad because as we all obviously the Father Time is going to be catching up to The Undertaker, and he's not going to be wrestling forever. I realize that. I don't like it, but I realize it.
Just imagine.
That's just the inner fan in me.
I mean, actually,
that
WrestleMania
really wants him to last forever.
But I mean, I'm saying if it actually happens, WrestleMania 31, I want to see it being the main event. Because this is a match that people, I think, the number one dream match that you can possibly get right now in the stage of the game. Take over the Sting.
Absolutely.
It has to happen. I mean, I think it has to happen for history, you know, to move on. Because, I mean, take like you said, getting up there. But at the same time, he still can put on a great show, in which his last
Absolutely.
Few years, I think he has left him in his system to actually continue to do this and have that, you know, match with WrestleMania. I think his best win can be against Sting if they really play their cards right.
You know, and they train for it and give, you know, don't allow Sting to wrestle at all, or maybe one or two matches here and there, but to train and work with The Undertaker as far as the psychology, you know, both are really good at this. I mean, both have got over 30 years in the wrestling business. It would be a great opportunity to see something special. A lot of matches that people wanted to see that didn't end up happening, you know, that coulda, woulda, shoulda, but just didn't.
And what makes
Taker's
matches so special is that he plans, and like I was reading this, he plans them weeks in advance. Like WrestleMania can be on, you know, April 6th. He'll be planning it right now. Again, with Brock Lesnar, you know, like I was reading that with Kurt Angle, that they met up in a coffee shop and planned their entire match at WrestleMania when they had it. And not why am I saying Kurt Angle? I'm talking about Shawn Michaels. And they plan the entire thing, and that's why it's so good, because they plan it weeks in advance when some guys are planning the day of or even hours before. That's why Taker's match is always the best one in the card, usually. In most cases, like for at least for the past years, it always outshined anything they put up.
Yeah.
And you know what's cool about Taker's match is that that you don't have to have like 37 billion weeks of build-up. They get it all done within maybe a few months. And it's that good. It's probably it's usually the most built up, you know. I'm not saying most, but I'm saying they get the job done every single year with Taker in any match that he has against anybody.
Absolutely. But, you know, we'll delve more into this conversation more. Hopefully we'll have Zach back with us on Saturday. But we'll talk more about this in depth this Saturday night as we continue on with the last ride tour of Saturday Night Slam. I'm going to go ahead and cut it short tonight. Cut it to an end tonight because I know Austin's he needs to get his rest, get fired up and get energized for this weekend. Again, we want to thank Oscar
Saturday
for taking
Night
time
Slam.
To join us and talk about his time in wrestling. God bless him. We wish him the best. On behalf of Austin and myself for Pipebomb Radio on this Wednesday night, we thank you all for joining us. And I always end it with my same shtick. Keep your feet on the ground and keep reaching for the stars. Good night, everybody. Good night, Austin.
Good night.
Yo, this is something I'm fucking something like this. Another bad track, so this is just one of those shit. And let me laugh, I'm feeling like I'm getting the vibe. Better causes a bro, so take a woman to go like this. I wear a jacket, but it's been a bit of a wrong choice. My road sleep, so yo, I know you're rolling my ass. To get a bigger figure, get machine to study me. And I know where that paper is around the world or heartbreak. The many think I'm fucking, yo, had to have a breakdown. Pay you fools, so now you know where my baby's round. Taking it right back up and scooping across to find a school shovel. Not from the ghetto, but to take you to another level. But hold on, to your woman Jesus. Now that I'm rich, so many women wanna do me and make a damn say damn. I'm finally talking more, say your homie damn. Now let me speak for the week, I'm either rookie. My time is held up extremely for cookies. Just let me fly the strip in 96. And you don't bother me and I show up and won't bother you. And you just watch it, brother, flowing like Niagara. Think me fucking stupid, cause these chickens are my stack, yeah. Although I'm labeled with a black face, it goes deep, so my phone goes left. Cause I got it made. I broke the leader once again because I had to. When you're like 31, baby, yo, I can hide. You just tell me what you're saying, yo. Anyway, it's okay. Your place to mine all night until the next day. Look, do the ditty again. Roll to me, cause then I can tell you if I roll to you. Do the ditty again. Roll to me, cause then I can tell you if I roll to you. Do the ditty again. Roll to me, cause then I can tell you if I roll to you. Do the ditty again. Roll to me, cause then I can tell you if I roll to you. From the top, second verse of the church, y'all. What's the conclusion? I should be happy for the church, y'all. And since the 9 o'clock, I grip G. It's like every system that I be like, do you remember me? I hope my end is not over my whole Toledo. Keep me chugging like Fredo, so this is like on my ego. I have a tendency to flow, start off with my own group and pick up the mic. And all of a sudden, I see high moving guesses like magic. And faithful voice is a magician. If I was a vacuum, I'd be stuck in a competition. Let it ride again, and you'll believe I got my own thing. Straight behind my home, so meet me with the chicken soul train. And I'ma break my note, to the show is open. So I had a dash when I took it with me for a smoking. A black man trying to make it, and that ain't no fair. But just like you, you see, I think you say, look, do the ditty again. Roll to me, cause then I can see if I roll to you. Do the ditty again. Roll to me, cause then I can see if I roll to you. Do the ditty again. Roll to me, cause then I can see if I roll to you. Do the ditty again. Roll to me, cause then I can see if I roll to you. Let's take a trip to another land. Find a grip, come back and watch the whole stand. Chopping up like so, and roll out to my cabin. Believe me, my brother will host me. You can imagine, all on a diggling. Just because it go great, and I'm like a summer show. You ain't heard a damn thing. And shoot it at the gym, hatch strap for protection. Because to me, my life is more than my erection. And you can, if you a fan, it ain't over yet. If you a DJ, do a pickle boy, make the ocean sweat. Take it down inside the microphone, all for free notes. Take your man, shut up my host. Like Doritos, it ain't my fault. I laid a fight with concern, and I hit the mouth. Burning brother, brother's money earned.